Brandon Richburg is what Texans call a cowboy. He doesn't have a gun or a lasso, but he's adept on horseback and travels from cattle ranch to cattle ranch where he rounds up cows to bring them to auction. In East Texas, where he lives, the region is littered with ranches, which are usually a lot greener than they are right now.
What does it normally look like here?
Well, it's normally grass is this tall and green, you know, and not brown.
It's a lot brown.
Yeah, it's real brown.
Well, how bad are things right now?
I think they're real bad, really bad.
Cattle ranching is a water-intensive business. A single cow could consume as much as 30 gallons of water each day. But in Texas, there just hasn't been enough to go around this year. More than half of the state is currently undergoing severe to exceptional drought conditions, according to the U.S. Drought Monitor.
When the drought is this bad, what sort of effects does it have on the ranching industry?
Oh, it's just, economical. Cows run out of something to eat, and then, you know, you got to think about the winter, and you got to think about what hay's going to cost, the hay that you usually bale that you're not baling, that you're having to buy. That's costing 2 times as much or 3 times as much. And I have seen some people putting out hay to their cows right now.
It's very early.
Very, very early. Considering, you know, you usually start in the middle of December. You start right now, where we're at 1st of August, you know, it's going to be a long winter.
How do you stay in business?
That's going to be a good question.
For months, ranchers held out hope that the rain would come. But with winter looming and still not enough water or food to go around, Texas ranchers have had little choice but to sell off cows they can no longer afford to care for.
I'm at the largest cattle auction house in eastern Texas. The auction today started at 11 a.m. It's expected to go into the night, which is way later than normal. But right now, so many ranchers are settling their cattle because of the drought that there's a line of trailers around the outside just to get cows into the holding pen over there. Is it normal for there to be this many cattle up for auction?
No, this really, people are having to sell their cows to keep them from basically starving to death or from having to put the extra money into them where they no longer become a business. You can only put so much money into a business before the business goes bankrupt.
How many cows did you sell today?
18. I got to reduce my value, you know. I ain't got no grass, so I ain't going to grow no more this year. So I got 4 places, and on 2 places, I got 2 ponds. It's completely dry, no water.
Yeah, I mean, some of the cows that were coming through here today were having trouble just walking through.
Trash cow, weak. That means there ain't no grass, and cowboys ain't got the money to feed them.
Paul Craycraft, who runs the auction house, hasn't just noticed a sharp increase in sales. He's also seen a simultaneous drop in the number of ranchers looking to buy cattle.
Normally, let's say our cow run would be somewhere around 250 to 300 cows this time of the year. We're selling from 600 to 700 cows. On a normal year, half or 60% of those cows out of the 300 would go back home to some other producer. And instead of 40% of them going to slaughter, we're seeing 75% go to slaughter. And it's not just here, it's every cell across Texas. The drought actually started several years ago on the West Coast. They have been under, well, there's not many cattle left out there. We saw it moving to, you know, Arizona, and it's just like you can watch it come this direction. So we're in a survival mode right now.
David Anderson studies livestock economics at Texas A&M University. He knows that it's only a matter of time before the mass cow sell-off begins to affect the rest of the industry, forcing many ranchers out of the business and causing fluctuations in the price of beef.
What sort of downstream effects does that have when cattle ranchers are selling off their cattle to be slaughtered instead of keeping them, you know, through their lifespan as they often do?
We have both kind of short-term effects and long-term effects. Oftentimes in the short term, everybody's really forced to sell at the same time. The drought becomes severe enough that you just can't buy hay, you can't afford to buy enough hay to keep all of your animals. So, and everybody's in the same boat. So we start selling off herds, but that doesn't last very long because sooner or later we've culled all the animals we're going to cull from the herd. So we start getting big declines in beef production longer term. And really the pressure then is on higher prices for consumers.
Does that worry you?
Well, I think in terms of cattle numbers, beef production, prices to consumers, it does.
What's the drought monitor telling you right now?
The drought monitor looks worse and worse for Texas, the Southwest. So those longer term forecasts would suggest we're going to be in that this drought is going to continue.
For an industry that is so dependent on climate, the cattle ranching industry seems not that willing to talk about the potential that some of these changes, extreme heat, the potential for extreme drought, might be permanent or might last a long time.
That whole subject is, certainly for a lot of people, is pretty controversial. But, you know, we might have maybe more common droughts, more severe droughts. And so if they happen more often and they're more severe, we may not have as many cows in some places as we do in other places, just simply because the ability of the land to carry those cows is not as great or is more variable.
Raising fewer animals is a tough compromise for ranchers, especially in Texas, where the average cattle ranch is home to only about 30 cows. It's part of why Rachel Cotrere is hopeful her family's long-held practice of raising Brahmins, a type of cow native to India which is better suited for hot and dry climates, will catch on.
We're here at BRC Ranch. We are a Brahmin cattle operation in Bowling, Texas, and where we're actually at now is our show barn, which is...
These are the best of the best.
The best of the best for Brahmin cattle.
So what's special about these particular cattle?
So if you look at their skin, you can see they have a really short hair coat, almost no hair coat. So it keeps them very cool in the summer. Also, you notice they have a lot of extra skin under their necks compared to a lot of other breeds. So Brahmins have four times the sweat glands of a normal, like say Angus or Hereford type cow. So the more skin they have, the more sweat they can produce. And that helps them keep cool in the summer too.
Have you seen an uptick in interest because of the weather lately, because of the drought here in Texas and in the Western United States?
I have definitely seen an interest in Brahmin cattle in the last 2 years, really, 2 to 3 years, because people realize that they need cattle that can survive this hot weather.
Cotrere and her husband Brandon make most of their money selling the semen of their purebred show cows, which are coveted around the world. A single highly sought-after sample can go for as much as $100,000. But you don't have to be a millionaire to buy some of their Brahmin cow semen. Most samples cost less than $100.
Why aren't more ranchers doing this? Why aren't more ranchers buying Brahmins or Brahmin cross breeds?
I think people like tradition, and you know, like, I think a lot of ranchers maybe feel like a certain affinity to a certain breed, and that's why they aren't implementing crossbreeding, but it's easy to implement crossbreeding and keep your herd.
Is it fair to say that maybe we're approaching an inflection point where you kind of don't have a choice? Either you start to adapt or you're out of the business?
Well, you can see in a lot of examples through the history of the beef cattle business, the people that adopt the technologies early are the ones that can excel in the long run because you just have an advantage over others. And I mean, here at our ranch, we're sold out of Brahmin bulls. As soon as we get bulls ready to start breeding, we have buyers wanting them because people want to use the crossbreeding and they want to stay in business ultimately. And they know that they may have to change a little bit to adapt to the changing climate and the changing drought conditions.
When a potential buyer comes to visit, we'll ride through and look at those cattle over there under the trees. Those are actually half Brahmin, half Angus cows. And then there'll be some black white-faced ones that are whose mothers were half Brahmin and half Hereford. And so by doing that, we can get the good traits of all of those breeds and make an exceptional animal. That's environmentally adapted.
In all our time here, we haven't heard, not once, uttered the words climate change. Is that just like totally taboo in the industry or in the area?
Yeah, I mean, it's a controversial issue, but something is definitely going on.
One thing you can say about nearly every rancher is they love their land, and their land is a part of who they are. And if you don't take care of the land, your land can't take care of your cattle and your cattle can't take care of you as a family. And so, I mean, our priority is taking care of the land.
I mean, there's no arguing. Things are changing. To what degree, I don't know. But what I want to do for the welfare of my family's future is just to be ahead of it as much as we possibly can.
By the time the auction ended, it was well past 9 p.m. Roughly 2,300 cows were sold, and most of them were headed to slaughter. As for the ranchers, they're still holding out hope that this whole drought thing will go away soon.
You just have to wait till the grass comes back and buy more cows. That's a cattleman, I'm telling you, as I've told a lot of people in my life. We're closer to God, I think, than anyone is because we totally, totally and completely depend on Him.
Is there any fear that this is like a direction that just like the climate is heading in? Like it's been real hot?
No, I totally and completely depend on God. And whatever He wants is the way it's gonna go, and we can't do anything about it except just try and hold on through it.
I'm Michael Learmonth, Editor-in-Chief of Vice News. Too often, traditional news outlets shy away from the real stories and experiences of those living through global conflicts, not Vice News. Our reporters are on the ground, fearlessly covering the human stories that shape our world. You and millions of others can continue to read, watch, and listen to Vice News for free. But we hope you'll consider making a one-time or ongoing contribution of any size at vice.com/contribute. Every contribution, no matter how big or small, helps support the journalism Vice News brings to you every day. Thank you.